design process. Would you guys agree when you buy stuff, if the engineers would design the stuff in a way, and if the factories would build the stuff in a way that takes sustainability into account before you actually go into production, you're probably going to have a more sustainable operation and product. My research shows that if you look at engineers and engineering schools and engineering curriculums, and you talk to engineers in the workplace, and you ask them, when you design stuff, what do you evaluate it on? Cost, quality, service, better, faster, cheaper. You start asking engineers questions like, how about greenness, recyclability content, all that stuff that has anything remotely to do with sustainability? Like, when the product's done, is it going to end up in a landfill? My research basically shows, I don't even know what you're talking about. When I went to college, we have great curriculums, but I wasn't trained on greenness. I was trained on better, faster, and cheaper. Cost, quality, service, flexibility. I'm the best in the world at it, and our companies are great at it, but they weren't trained on it. So you can make the argument that until academia and colleges train our engineers on sustainability, chances are we're not going to actually be designing products and sticking parts together that are actually more sustainable. The other part of it too is I talked to a few engineers and they said there's so many paradoxes associated with sustainability in the design process that we get confused. For example, in the auto industry, if you increase the recyclability content of a material in a car or truck, that sounds like sustainability to me. And there's a push to use less and less virgin material and use more recycled material. They have data now that basically shows in the auto industry, when you increase the recyclability content of cars and trucks, it weighs more. So, okay, wait a second, fuel economy goes down, but the recyclability content goes up. So I'm an engineer, like, what do I do? The other part of it too is, in the auto industry, if you use virgin material, this is how an engineer explained it to me, if you use virgin material in terms of performance specifications, it works really well when you use virgin material. Like when it's in the sun, it doesn't melt. When it's in the cold, it doesn't freeze. When you use recycled material, its material composition, instead of looking like this, starts to look like this, and it doesn't operate as well, like if there's a fire, if it's super cold. Now the engineer's like, wait a second, I've increased the recyclability content, now that's actually going to impact the quality of the product. So there's a paradox there, and engineers are really struggling with what happens when we hit that wall. The answer to that is leadership. The leadership needs to say what to do in that situation. Employees are only going to do what they're evaluated on. If they're evaluated on cost, quality, and service, that's what they're going to focus on. They're probably going to be really good at it, but they're going to brush the green stuff to the side. How do you successfully implement a socially responsible management system? Like I said, all these standards focus on one specific thing. If there's a broader framework that's a little more all-encompassing, that makes sense, that's efficient, that works, and that's what my former student is working on, and I think that has some potential because he's got some companies that have a reputation for being really good at sustainability. So I think that's got some legs to it. Lack of measures. We have a lot of companies saying, I just don't know how to measure stuff that has to do with greenness, therefore I'm not inclined to actually pursue this stuff. Let me throw it at you this way. If you have your own business, if you work for a company, if there's something that the company doesn't like measure like crazy, do you think they're really good at that thing or really bad? They suck at it. Data shows if there's something you don't measure in detail, you're probably very, very bad at it. If you don't measure your costs are probably out of control. If you don't measure your quality probably sucks. If you don't measure your service is probably really bad. We have a lot of companies saying this stuff is so hard to measure and attach dollar signs to. That in itself is making us less inclined to even make decisions on the stuff. So if you can't measure it, how do you make decisions on it? Last one, adversarial relationship with local, state, and federal regulators. I picked up on this because I don't know this stuff. I have to ask the questions and talk to people in the real world. According to my colleagues in the workplace, most of which work for American companies, they say they have a terrible relationship with regulators. They come in with notepads ready to issue citations. All they do is buy permits. They don't get a lot of coaching from regulators. Then I'll talk to some non-American managers, like especially in Europe, and they seem to imply that they have a different relationship with the regulators. Their version of the EPA will actually walk into a German car factory and say, you know what, we've been working on this new technology that will let you paint cars and trucks without emitting bad stuff into the atmosphere. We've already made some of that investment on your behalf. with a little more investment on your behalf, not only could you be more environmentally responsible, the quality is a little better. Long term, this will actually be cheaper. So the German car makers started a painting process called powder coated that doesn't use petrochemicals, years ahead of the American companies because they had a better relationship with their regulators. When you're painting stuff in a factory, like the stuff that you buy, when the paint leaves the gun, the paint's very wet. It needs to stay wet so that when it sticks onto whatever it is that you're going to buy, it dries really well and looks really nice. You have to have tons of oil in the paint to keep it nice and wet so that when it hits the car, it dries on it just right. Now they're using a powder that doesn't have any oil solvents that keeps it just as wet, but without using petrochemicals that emit bad stuff into the atmosphere. So in that case, a good relationship with regulators helped German industry be way ahead of American industry on something where, compared to the American side, quality wasn't good and it was costing them more. They had to pay for permits for all that stuff that they were emitting into the atmosphere. Sometimes they would actually have to shut down the entire plant because they exceeded their permit requirements. If you go into any factory in America and you look for where the bottleneck is, the slowest part of the manufacturing process, it tends to usually be the paint shop because quality is really important there, but it tends to have something to do with permits and the environment and emitting too much bad stuff into the atmosphere. Okay. I will, if you go to the next page, second to last page, page 8. This is the way I look at it. This is what I try to tell my students. Here's the future of sustainability. You can ignore this stuff. I think that's a bad mood. You can do the bare minimum. I think that's a bad move because you're going to have a cost of doing business that the competition doesn't have that's leading the way. Sustainability leaders are not in it for better publicity or ethical reasons. I'm starting to pick up on it. Nike, Microsoft, Coors, Kellogg's. When you start really talking to these sustainability managers, the first thing I've noticed is they have dialogue with the CEO of the company. Those companies that I mentioned at the beginning that want nothing to do with sustainability to the extent that they want our students trained in this stuff, I went online and I looked, who's the most important person in sustainability at that company? And it's several levels of management below the VP level. I always say, if there's not a VP of sustainability, it's never gonna be too important at that company. If you wanna know what's important to that company, find out who the CEO talks to on a daily basis. Right now in American manufacturing, the vice president of supply chain management talks to the CEO of a company probably 20 times a day. That's the CEO saying, what you do is really important because you can help me really widen margins. So again, I think there's a leadership void, especially on this topic. The view of value will continue to broaden. Customers will demand. Customers want stuff at the lowest price possible. When you buy an iPhone, you're not saying, please charge me as much as you possibly can. You want value. You want to pay as little as possible. You want it quickly made. You want it yesterday. You want it quickly designed. You want it to have perfect quality. You want extensive variety. Today you want red, tomorrow you want blue. Today you want 10 units, tomorrow you want 1,000 units. So companies out there basically have to give their customers everything and anything that they want. And I would argue that we, as customers and consumers, are also gonna say they're also generated by processes which are environmentally and socially responsible. So at the bottom there, I've asked the question, responsible practices will contribute to waste reduction, which will also ultimately lead to profit improvements. I get this question, does a company have to have lots of money and be profitable to be sustainable? Or do you need to be sustainable to be very profitable? I would argue that sustainability requires some money in the bucket, but I'll also argue if you make that investment long term, you're actually going to be more profitable because of that. If you ignore sustainability, your costs are going to be much higher, you won't be profitable, so you don't stand a chance, and you'll go out of business because you're not price competitive. So I think a sustainability is one of those things that companies have to attach themselves to, whether they like it or not, but the end result is anything to do with sustainability is a form of waste, which has everything to do with profit. Okay, last slide. I'm not even going to read that. This is the next stage of my research. I walked away from this green stuff because when I did my dissertation 20 years ago on environmentally responsible manufacturing, it was a little trendy, and then it kind of just disappeared a little bit. It didn't gain the momentum that I thought it would. And I have an ego, I'm selfish. When I do research and I publish, I want to get it published fast and I want it in the best journals. To do that, you kind of have to pick up on topics that are timely. Like I can't do research in something and expect it to be published if no one cares about it, if it's not popular. So rather recently, the research that I replaced the green stuff with had to deal with risk management. Companies have so much risk that it's costing them and it's burning them. For example, car and truck plants in Michigan shut down because Atlanta got half an inch of snow 2 winters ago. They literally had to shut down car and truck plants for 2 to 3 days because it snowed half an inch in Atlanta, because a lot of stuff comes through a railway hub through Atlanta to Chicago, where the car parts go to when it comes from the East Coast. There was a strike on the West Coast this semester that shut down some car and truck plants because people at the ports that were getting the parts in from Japan were saying, I'm not touching them, so they were sitting in containers out in the Pacific Ocean. Lots of companies take lots of risks to do things better, faster, and cheaper. If I buy a part from Indiana, way, way less risky than buying a part from China. But in their pursuit of doing things better, faster, and cheaper, they've got all sorts of risk built into their companies and supply chains, so they're obsessed with it. So I'm doing research right now on how can you still take those risks but mitigate against them so that you're proactive, so that nothing bad happens. Or if something bad happens, you have a contingency plan in place to deal with that so your factory isn't shut down for 3 days. You know, a simple example is you buy all of your parts from one supplier. Why? That's the best way to get the best price. You dump the entire volume on one supplier. Yeah, you probably do get the best price that way, but what happens if there's a strike or a fire at that supplier? How about you split it 70-30? I'll buy 70% from you, 30% from you. I might have to pay a little more with this 30% because they got a lower volume, but if something bad over here happens, I have a contingency plan. But corporate America hates that because they're not getting the best price for every single part that they buy. So when you're that greedy, I guess, you introduce risk. So I'm doing research on, okay, if you're gonna be risky, how do you be less risky and still get the value that you're looking for? And what I've noticed is I'm visiting all these companies that have great reputations on risk management. I picked up on they're kind of good at sustainability. It's like, what's going on there? They hate risk, but they'll take it, but they take it as proactively as possible. Would you guys agree that pollution, waste, sustainability, all that stuff is kind of like a form of risk for companies? Doesn't it have liability associated with it? So if you're obsessed with managing risk, why don't you just look at your waste streams and say, how can we reduce them? Because it's sitting there, and you know what? That's a risk. When we send something to a landfill, today it might be legal. The government could come back 5, 10, 15, 20 years later and say, we've decided that that's illegal. Because you know what? It's contaminating the water supply. And we're not paying for it. You're gonna have to pay for it. Company says, no, when we put it there, you said it was legal. Government says, well, yeah, we changed our minds. You know, Superfund legislation, stuff like that. They can do it, and they do. So that's the next phase of my research is risk management, and I'm starting to pick up on, why are they good at sustainability? So I kind of stumbled across that. So that'll be like the next phase. Maybe if I could coach corporate America on being obsessed with risk, it becomes more sustainable without them realizing that they are, and then we live in a better place. Because sustainability by itself as a topic isn't intriguing to a lot of decision makers that I'm talking to. All right, I talked really fast. It's 60 degrees and sunny outside. Do you have any questions or just opinions or feedback? Anybody? Yeah?
It seems like from the part, the beginning, what you talked about was money and the focus on money. Isn't holistic accounting the issue? Because if you're, your engineers are just going to be following the leader of trying to maximize, you know, graphs to whatever. But the whole corporation is looking at making the profit. So if you have, if you can metricize those, like the pollution, et cetera, that seems like the issue. And you have to harmonize internationally, because your competition doesn't have that focus, and they're...
Are using different standards.
Liquidating natural capital, mm-hmm. and turning into income, then they're going to have that temporary advantage. So you have to decrease the advantage of the competition and level of playing field.
Yep.
Because it's laws, enforcing laws, and then having holistic accounting that keeps track of everything all at the same
Absolutely.
Time.
Absolutely.
Some of those other things would just fall into place if that were true.
Absolutely. Are you an accountant?
No.
Okay.
No. A book I just read, I've read other things like this, but there was a book by Jane Gleason White called Six Capitals, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, in general, I haven't read it.
It's a pretty superficial book, but it drops a lot of names, and it's so much to chew on at one time. Always these executives and managers, they choke on this stuff. It's too much at one time.
If I was an accounting PhD, let me throw this out there. If you get your PhD in business and specialize in accounting, the going rate for PhDs in accounting is about $150,000-$160,000 base pay 8 months. There's a shortage, and most of our accounting professors are going to be retiring in the next 5 to 10 years. So if you want to talk about, if you're studious and academic about a field and specialty that has some dollar signs associated with it, I would argue that the biggest, because you would think in accounting, it hasn't changed for decades, never will. There's a huge research void, and it's that void that you just talked about. So if I was a new accounting PhD, that'd be totally my research stream.
And you have to make, because it's, even though I think your point on ego is about an individual person, the corporation isn't a person. We artificially make it a person in this country, but it's psychopathically focusing on a very simple goal. So you have to have punishment, and that punishment is taking away money, which adds into that holistic accounting. So it's for the masses that aren't those people, it's punishment you have to do. You have to shift the profit model. So it has to take into account. I don't think it's going to be moral or whatever. It's going to be forced.
Yep.
It has to be forced.
The accounting standards that we use in this country are antiquated for the purposes of promoting sustainability.
They externalize all this stuff.
Psychopathically making decisions. I like it. Yeah. Yeah.
Change.